Gut. Wir schauen mal, ob wir uns finden im Internet. Ja, gerne.
Hey there.
Hello.
Hello, hello. Let me get the picture on. Okay, hi.
Hi, how are you?
Is this the right time?
Yes, we're now on the right time.
Oh, good. So not 10 o'clock.
No. There was a misunderstanding there, right?
That would call it 10 o'clock. And I thought, no, that's not right. Karen very carefully arranged with me that it was 9:15.
Hi, Dallas. It's great to see you. There's a crowd waiting for you. And just turn around the computer for a second for you in order for you to see who is there, right?
Okay, good.
So here we go.
Hello, hello.
So it's great to have you here. We had a full day of presentations on alternative living, on woods, on what else did we have? What was the first one on? I cannot remember anymore. Ecofeminism. Ecofeminism, right. And biodiversity. It was, and we also learned why there are only daughters, so there are no sons. So this is...
That sounds good. Hey, I'm going to disappear from the camera for 2 seconds and turn the fan off overhead.
Okay.
Because that circulating will bother people. I meant to do that before you called, but then email intervened. So I wish I had been there. The day sounds magnificent.
Yes, it was. And I thought we would start with a little reasoning about the title of this event, because this event is called We're All Family, or All of Us Are Family. And I remembered in another conversation, you had quite interesting ideas about family, and also probably, I mean, that's something that is on my mind a little bit, is can we really be all family? It seems to be a really hard task to be family with everybody all the time.
Well, depends on what you mean by family and also at what scale one is speaking. I have taken to using the less familiar English term kin, because kin doesn't quite so readily end up meaning an enclosed familial space, a domestic space. Kin is a less familiar term and therefore somewhat more easily open to resignification in interesting ways. And as you know, kin making is something I write about and care about a great deal. And I think that if you have kin, the kin has you. If you have a cousin, the cousin has you. If you have a river, the river has you. That kin brings with it relationships of accountability and reciprocity that are not necessarily symmetrical or equal, but that the kin isn't just, hey, we're all together as a great oneness. The kin is about a kind of discernment of relationship and a kind of accountability that has to be enacted in body, soul, and mind. I would call it a kind of ethical accountability is involved in kin making. It doesn't have to be biogenetic, although clearly biogenetic kin making is ongoing and needs to be nurtured and cared for properly. But that kin making is much broader than that, and that making kin non-biogenetically, in my view, is urgent on all sorts of levels, both human and more than human. Including rivers and rocks and mountains and landscapes and the peoples, human and non-human, who belong to those landscapes and waters. So that making kin, also you can't make kin willfully from just one side. Yes. At some level, you have to be recognized in order to be kin. Marilyn Strathern told a funny story that I repeat when she was talking about the word relatives in mm-hmm. English. Uh-huh. And she said, first of all, she was astonished to learn that the word relatives in English only came to mean familial, family relatives, well into the 18th century, quite late. It had previously been used pretty exclusively for mathematical relationships, but came to mean familial relationships late. And she said it implied the kind of thing that, let's say you're a upper bourgeoisie and you're coming home and the maid comes to the door and says that a cousin that you have never met and didn't even know existed is on the sofa in your sitting room. Okay. And all of a sudden, you are accountable for that cousin's debts. You know, all of a sudden that cousin can make demands on you, even though you didn't even know the cousin existed. But if you recognize the cousin and the cousin recognizes you, there are consequences. So I think kinmaking has consequences. And no, it's not just everybody all the time, nor is it without conflict, and that it is both possible and I think necessary to say, not just say in some weak sense, no, we are not kin. I am not your kin. I am cutting those ties. Or we are not going to build those ties, because it's important to be able to exclude as well as include, in practical and finite ways.
Yes, that's also the feeling that I have had, and it's quite an interesting tension between relatives being always a surprise, so you can never foresee who is going to have his demands laid on you, and at the same time. It also implies the necessity to exclude at times, because
it does.
Exactly, and you cannot be responsible for everything and everybody all the time.
And also the necessity to interrupt one's life to respond to needs that come at inconvenient times. In personal terms, one might be at odds, let's say, with one's mother or one's brother, having had a really hard time for 30 years, but then that person is elderly and sick. Well, it's time to interrupt one's own life and respond to make sure that person is taken care of. If you can't do it yourself, to be part of the arrangements that respond to that person's needs. Well, I think the same thing is true of land. This land has supported me. I am kin to and belong to this land. And the land's troubles require my response, whether they're convenient or not. If I'm going to use narrative language like being kin to the land and its beings, I also have to ask, by what right do I call myself kin to this land? Since this is, of course, in my case, in California, occupied conquest land. I'm a white settler colonist. So what could it mean that I belong to this land? And then what are the consequences and requirements for that belonging to be something other than ongoing exploitation? Mm-hmm. So I think kinmaking involves all those questions.
Yes.
We agreed to talk a little bit about storytelling and about sharing stories. You once mentioned in a conversation, an earlier conversation, that the role of indigenous storytelling, both narrative and material, in your book was kind of never really seen. And at the moment, the two of us are, out of some strange reasons, drawn into environmental justice movement struggles in a country quite remote, both for you and for me, that namely in Colombia. So we were drawn into friendship and friendship networks over there. And so we decided to start talking a little bit about the narratives you encountered there and I encountered there. That make for such a strange, speculative, but also very down-to-earth storytelling approach. So probably you want to start. I also brought one story with me for a later moment.
Absolutely. So first of all, I want to qualify in that I think both indigenous and other than indigenous storytelling, but that all of that is really important, so that all of the stories into which I felt invited in Colombia, not all of them were indigenous. Many of them are in complex ways, and that it's I think it's very important to cultivate and open up the stories that work for a robust and flourishing world with many categories. And it's absolutely true in staying with the trouble that I've been really quite upset that reviewers have on the whole not noticed the Black Mesa Water Coalition or the Never Alone Alliances for the Inupiaq online game or the Malagasy collaborations around the storybooks, and that I made it. I quite deliberately cultivated several kinds of art science activist practices in that book to foreground the contemporary complexity of indigenous storying and acting for lands and waters and air. And on the whole, reviewers don't comment. I don't know if they don't see it. I don't know if they don't understand that it takes up, you know, more than a third of the book.
Yeah, it's a big chapter.
So I've been quite upset about that and have asked myself why. And I think it's a collective problem. So Colombia, I was invited to Colombia by a colleague who I had met but didn't really know well in person. Tanya Bustos Perez, and an S Science Technology and an STS Science Technology Society colleague who studies design in textiles and the practices of textile design and textile making. She was my host and invited me to Colombia, introduced me to her colleagues and friends, and in the course of that, in three different places, Bogota, Santa Marta, and Bucaramanga, colleagues gave me a carrier bag, a mochila. Let me show you one of them. Does it show?
Beautiful.
And you see that there's a uterus.
Yes.
The bag. I didn't see that for a long time. And there is on there. And then let me show you the other two bags. This one, which is from Santa Marta.
That's the one from Santa Marta, yes.
Caribbean,
one of those,
right?
As well.
Unbelievably beautiful. These lines are storytelling lines of the Arhuaco people that I'll talk about in a second. And the colors are natural sheep's wool colors, as you know. And then this one from northeastern Colombia, the Wayuu.
That's the Wayuu.
Women that make these bags. Okay. So these were gifts. And then I was invited to do an introduction for a republication of Ursula Le Guin's The Carrier Bag Theory of Fiction. And Le Guin's story has been important to me for 40 years, really. Well, it was written in 1986 and circulated. And from 1986 to now, that story has been the foundation of the way I think about storytelling.
Yes.
That it's time to tell the untold story, the story for going on with each other, the story where the container and not the weapon, the container for holding a few seeds, a little water, something that can be given and received. My whole thinking in terms of the string figures was also about giving and receiving and sharing with each other something that can't be done with just one. So that the carrier bag theory of fiction is about the collecting and sharing and going on with each other in all of its layerings and complexities, which I think is what storytelling has to be. So narrative theory has to be different. It can't be the privileged signifier moving through matrix space and having adventures and getting the treasure and bringing it back. It can't be that shape of narrative, which is the one that's built into the history of narrative theory. So these bags are, on the one hand, just unbelievably sensuous, really amazing beings, if you will. They carry They carry the people who gave them to me. They carry the lives and struggles of the people who made them. In this case, one of the, I think the second largest open coal pit mine on the planet is in this area. And the damming of the river, the Rancheria River, for the purposes of the coal mine, use millions and millions of liters per day, leaving the people of the area with their aquifer drained in extreme desiccation and extreme drought, with less than a liter of water per person per day available. People gathered together in struggle for the land with other indigenous people making claims on the state and on the land. And as you know, in Colombia, the Constitution of, I think, 1991 opened up the space for indigenous peoples to make some claims on the state. Really terribly important struggles that are in the fibers of this bag. So as this bag is given to me and I return home with it, there is a sense in which I am accountable to what is in this bag. This bag carries consequences for my telling these stories, for building up alliances for the people engaged in the struggle, for paying attention to what is happening in Colombia right now, the people on the street all over the country, the defenders of the water of the Cauca River were marching in Bogota, I think, just yesterday.
Yes.
This bag is made by campesinos in the Cauca River area, women in defense of water and life, not indigenous in this case, but involved in textile activism, so that and this bag is made by people in the Sierra Nevada de Santa Marta. The president of the Indigenous Students Association in the Magdalena University in Santa Marta is the granddaughter of the woman who made this bag. Okay. She tells me their stories. She tells me about the history of mining, the history of Colombian settler colonialism up the mountain, contemporary gentrification, erosion, so forth. When I'm told these stories and then retell these stories, there is a web of relatedness and a web of accountability, a web of recognition and some kind of need to cultivate the capacity to respond meaningfully. One of the things that meant for me is that it sharpened my commitment to learning Spanish.
Yes,
Spanish is not an indigenous language of Colombia, but I have, it's the only one I have any hope of learning. And I actually, for the last, I think, 7 or 8 months now, I don't think there's a day gone by that I haven't spent something close to an hour learning Spanish from nothing. You know, so it's not like I'll ever be fluent in Spanish, but I can now read the reports in the Colombian newspapers. I can read about the environmental justice struggles. I can read about the complexities of Amazonia in Colombia and the destructions of Amazonia. I know something about the geography. I am now in some non-trivial way tied into the necessary storytelling for life and land and water.
Yes. No, this is an experience that I can really totally affirm. And I would like to add one more story that also did that to me. And that was a group in Buenaventura, which is a container port at the Pacific. A lot of Afro-Colombians live there, and they have been struggling against the container port for 20 years, more or less, because the container port destroys their means of subsistence. So initially, they actually came from pristine rainforests. They had to resettle to Buenaventura because of the conflict. Then they were able to sustain themselves for quite a while until the container port came. So now this city is called a port without people, because all those that live there cannot use the port waters anymore. They cannot use the mangrove forest anymore. They cannot use the land to plant their crops anymore. So what I encountered there was a group of activists, so to speak, who invited us to take a walk in their barrio in order to together remember and mourn an activist that was killed by the paramilitaries last year. So what they did was to set up little carteles, little signs, where the most significant spots of their struggle were kind of announced. And then, and that was so beautiful, people came out of their houses. It might have been Themistocles' daughter, his best friend, or whoever, and they would start telling the story of their struggle on spot. And this is how they developed a web of situated narratives that were also super impressive, because they connected the very local situation and the struggle with a very informed analysis of how transnational capital and the government in Colombia were those responsible for their situation. And we listened to those people, and I was there with a group of students, and we all had the feeling that it was our duty to record what we heard. We then did transcriptions, and we also had the feeling that it was our duty to translate. So we did two or three layered translations, like straightforward into German, and then other translations in order to connect the situation in Buenaventura to ours here in Austria. And this is where I felt very strongly that listening to a story implies an obligation for me as a listener. And that was for me a very, very impressive moment last year in Colombia.
These are transformative moments, and they also cultivate the capacity to partially heal lands and waters and peoples and each other. They cultivate they strengthen the struggle for ongoing for living well, living and dying well, and don't just give in to the the despair of just narrating one violation of the earth and its peoples after another. Because that kind of giving in, it's an indulgence, and we need each other not to do that. We need each other to continue to narrate the stories of people going on with each other in with all of the wounds, of course, but with building things that matter. Also, I think that traveling is very important. I think of Hannah Arendt. And the practice of going visiting, and the cultivation of the capacity to be a polite visitor, the capacity to listen, to go outside one's own assumptions about the world. I think traveling in that deep sense is really important. And I also think it's critical to be aware of the storytelling that's going on where one lives. So I think of Laurie Palmer, an artist I have great respect for, who works at University of California, Santa Cruz, who's done many environmental justice and environmental art projects, one of which that she's been doing for about the last year is leading people on walks around the local scene, the Salinas River, where various kinds of fracking are, in the Monterey County, the various kinds of fracking threatened fracking and other kinds of extraction, the ongoing history of the missions, so forth. She's led people on local walks to generate conversation and to, people on the walks, resource people will know more and will tell people all kinds of things about local history and local resource struggles and so on, so that the sense of where I live becomes more strongly tied And I think it's as important to do that in one's own places as it is to link to places one visits or comes to know in some other way. I think of the current project that Benedicta Zitouni, whom I think you know, is doing on the port of Antwerp. Reminds me of some of the things you just said about the container port in Colombia. And of course, I live near the in the San Francisco Bay, and the whole history of shipping and ports, connected to that. That kind of becoming larger. There's a practice of knowing more, of curiosity, of really learning about real places in the world and their deep histories. And somehow that kind of curiosity, that kind of learning, I think has the effect of actually caring about these places and these human and non-human peoples, and joining an action where it's possible. And without storytelling, I don't know how we could begin to do that.
So probably let's cross over to a different genre, but and it's so interesting because now we talked about this strong interconnection between space and storytelling. Another genre you are very fond of, as am I, are science fiction stories, and one could also see that as a big opposition, because science fiction stories are about the future, about the planet far away, so they are not that localized in that sense. But I can, in your writing on science fiction, I can see that there is also this connection to the territories and to the big issue of the earth, of territories, of and so on. And you were so friendly to send me a little piece you wrote to explain, where you explained to Bruno Latour why science fiction is a very important tool for landing on Earth. And I'm asking you about that also because I just read the footnote on Bruno Latour and Carl Schmitt and the bacteria to the audience. So I would be interested in how you explain to Bruno Latour why science fiction stories are necessary tools for situating ourselves in environmental questions and beyond that.
Bruno and I have a long friendship really for each other and really deeply loving each other, and also struggling for the entire extent of this friendship over feminism and citation practices, over use of the imagery of war that he's so fond of, over a bunch of things. And simultaneously, he has taught me so much, so that there's this ongoing struggle. And he has tried at various times, I think recommended by you, recommended by Isabel Stengers, certainly recommended by me, to read feminist science fiction. But he's always said, I just can't. He said, Richard Powers is my idea of, that's as far as Richard Powers is all I need. And Richard Powers is fine. Nothing against Richard Powers, although I admit I find it difficult to read him.
Me too.
Whatever. I have nothing against, this is... So he said, okay, you have one last chance. This is probably the last big project. Who knows? The exhibit that's coming up in Karlsruhe on landing on Earth, his involvement in the development with colleagues like Alexandra Arenas and others to develop perspectival methodologies, techniques, instrumentation in critical zones in Earth that enlarge the sense of the earthliness and mutes the sense of looking from above, of a gaze from afar or from distance, but so that the instrumentation comes from place, from critical zones, so forth. Well, Bruno's deeply involved in that, and he said, look, he got one last chance to tell me why I should read science fiction. And, of course, I heard feminist science fiction in that. I wrote a dear Bruno letter for his catalog. And in the Dear Bruno letter, I quite deliberately foregrounded Afrofuturist and Afro-Indigenous contemporary writing, very recent writing for the most part. One could do any number of things with an assignment like that, because science fiction is such a large and diverse set of practices. And I limited myself to print fiction, not graphic comics, not film, not fan. You know, I've limited myself, if you will, to the novel, which is quite a limitation in the world of science fiction, since it's so much more than that, right? I'm interested in science fiction, as I think you are too, in part because it is an imperial genre. It is a practice of writing, a practice of being in the world dependent on exploration and conquest and settlement or extraction. It is clearly a colonial and imperial genre and that grapples with the, some of it just, you know, makes use of that frame and then goes with it and doesn't worry about any of the issues. But the fiction that I find really interesting grapples with exploration, with settlement, with... let me back up for a minute. I think science fiction is both an imperial and colonial genre and an ethnographic and anthropological genre.
Yes. Especially with Ursula K. Le Guin.
Exactly. Yes. But of course, anthropology is also dependent on the history of colonial expansion in complex ways, which it doesn't mute its, in fact, I think it strengthens its job of dealing with the consequences of unequal encounter and the what it really takes to know something that is not yourself, someone who is not yourself. All of those issues that are deep in anthropology, I think, are also deep in science fiction. So there is a raft of contemporary, an explosion of Afrofuturist writing. N.K. Jemisin is maybe the most famous, but hardly the only one, and I think her Stone Eaters series that deals, it's a huge trilogy that deals with the questions of an unstable, who knows, the room is falling apart. the fifth season, the season of a winter that could endure hundreds, if not thousands of years, precipitated by the coming apart of the tissue of the earth itself and a mutant group of people who can control the Temblors, but who are themselves a highly oppressed and contained group. And then stones themselves that are sentient beings and so forth. An elaborate worlding that is not Earth. It's also not a fiction of exploration and conquest, but it's here and not here. It's an elsewhere of planetary vulnerability. And she does very interesting things with questions of the diversity of peoples. None of her peoples are racialized in quite the same way that one would think of that in the last 500 years of Earth history, but it's kind of oblique and powerful way of dealing with questions of race and oppression. And I really appreciate what you can do with a kind of oblique vision that you often can't do with a more head-on description of the issues. There's that one. I also wrote about Joan Rohnhorse's Trial of Lightning and Storm of Locusts. Joan Rohnhorse herself is Afro-Hopi in background, writing about Diné or Navajo stories. And the stories that set up the fiction are the creation stories of the Navajo. Okay, so they're Diné stories. They're not, and that really matters. So that the monsters, the modes of action, the kinds of heroism, the sorts of danger, these are all things that are worked through a reworking of Diné stories of the Holy people, and that it produces quite a different structure of narrative being. Okay, they're also up to the minute. Maggie Hosky is sort of a bad girl, a Diné monster slayer.
Very good.
She's quite an interesting character. Extremely modern. Extremely contemporary.
I always had the feeling that you have to be inclined to a bit of impurity if you like science fiction, because you can, with science fiction, you don't get rid of the violence of colonialism, for example, but you have the chance to understand better how deep the violence goes. So you don't take a stance of an outside stance in the history of violence. You're kind of drawn into the history of violence by the monster creatures and their battles.
There's no stance of innocence that's really possible. And again, I think of Ursula Le Guin, her book, The Word for World is Forest, as a good example of that. It's a little bit like Pandora in Avatar, only that was a ripoff from Le Guin's novel.
He stole it. Yeah. He just made the figures blue. So
literally, no, and she didn't pursue a copyright infringement, but certainly could have. Yeah. She talked about that a little bit when she was here. But the reason I bring it up in this context, it's a story of hyper-exploitation, hyper-oppression, and revolt, and then kicking the hyper-exploiters off, but declining to kill them, but rather putting the leader of the, kind of on an island to live out his life, in knowing the consequences of what he had done. And then the people of Ashea, I think is the name of the planet, telling the official who's visiting, who says, well, now you can go back to your previously peaceful life. And he says, no, there is no status quo ante. There is no going back. Now we have murdered each other, and live with the permanent consequences of that. So that in a way, there's a kind of a myth of a prior peaceful society. But leaving that aside for the moment, the important point is that that we live permanently with the consequences of history. Mm-hmm. And many of those are about ongoing violence and extraction and extermination, but also about building the capacity for caring with and for each other and for joy and for growing and for, making amazing food and making amazing kin and, really technological imaginations of, to die for. It's all of that. And I think science fiction deals with it.
Yes. Yes. And I also always had the feeling that this mechanism of mourning has something to do with this. So there's no way of approaching a version of ongoingness without the recognition of all the murders that happened. So good. Would you say that reading science fiction is a mode of mourning, or is that too much?
I think mourning is one of the threads in science fiction, mm-hmm. And that good science fiction, which is to say the science fiction I like. Anyway, I think that recognizing and bringing in, bringing the dead into the living, so as to recognize and go with the dead, not in some way, some fantasy of deathlessness or returning to a past or of not dying, but a kind of acknowledging loss that is enduring, that is real, that is not going away, in such a way as to let it be present, so as to strengthen the living. So that's the way, in a way, how I think about ancestors, that kind of making the ancestors mm-hmm. present, not in some kind of falsely spiritualist way. It would be falsely spiritualist were I to practice it that way, but a kind of acknowledging of the strong presence of the dead, in their strengths and their weaknesses and in the violences that they experienced, but also the violences that they resisted. The ancestors, in my case, like Marge France in social movements in Santa Cruz and elsewhere. Marge France is made present by bringing her into what is going on now, remembering strongly the instruction of the ancestors. Okay. Yes. So yeah, I think that those are practices of mourning, and I think some science fiction does that. So, for example, think of The Marrow Thieves, which is by a Métis author, name I'm blanking on, Anyway, The Marrow Thieves involves a fiction of the powerful ones can't dream anymore, and they think that the indigenous people have a genetic region that allows them to dream. And so they are capturing and performing genetic experimentation on indigenous people while further exterminating them out of a kind of revenge and resentment. And they're marrow thieves. They are bone marrow thieves. They are thieves of bodily substance, which is, you know, clearly a metaphor for the whole history of conquest. And the peoples, the indigenous peoples of North America, Eastern North America, and Canada, and this Canada and the United States in this case, you know, strengthen each other and come together, including in their acknowledgement of what they inherit through their marrow, mm-hmm. right? So the dead are present in the living, not in the sense of a DNA region that can be extracted and implanted in others. You know, it's not like that kind of inheritance. It's a whole other ontology of inheritance.
Mm. Yeah, but still then there's this ability to formulate drastic images. So that's, of course, also
right.
an important thing, that it's not only about like the symbolic world, but it's really drastic images that makes one understand how deep violence can really go.
Very bodily. The
drasticality is very important, I think.
That's right.
Yeah.
And I think science fiction is good at exploring the consequences of near apocalypse, just post-apocalypse, periods of crisis. Mm. I think science fiction is very good at exploring crisis.
Indeed. We do have the possibility for couple of questions from the audience. So if you would like to come forward, then you can also use the camera or just the microphone. Everybody is paralyzed.
Who wants first? Have you had a long day?
Configuration.
But maybe people will come up with questions or comments. No?
Maybe someone would tell me about a book I should read.
I mean, I can tell you about the beautiful coincidence that right now there's not only this beautiful symposium on why we are all family, but there's also a beautiful exhibition on how Ursula K. Le Guin and Octavia Butler have been and are now received in the visual arts here. So it's a brilliant exhibition, and I had the possibility to see it, and that might it's also interesting for me. Do you have any idea what is the momentum of the reappearance of the great feminist science fiction authors right now? Because it's in the exhibition you can see young artists fascinated by literature from the 70s and 80s. Did you experience anything like this yourself? I mean, and I experienced that a lot with my students as well. They are really super drawn into feminist science fiction from the 70s.
And the 80s.
And the 80s.
thinking of, yes, absolutely. And there are many reasons for that. I think that the period of the 70s and 80s were periods of really fierce, brave, over-the-top speculative feminism and speculative, that it was a strong, speculative, affirmative political practice in demonstration, in writing, in music, in presence. And I think Butler and Le Guin, I also think of Jewel Gomez.
Yes.
You know, there are really several figures from that period. Also, I think that both Le Guin and Butler nurtured and cultivated young writers. So Le Guin spent a lot of time in writers' workshops, in responding to young writers, and Butler did too. And then they both have died recently, right? And so there's a kind of a celebrating and mourning both of them. There's Octavia's Brood, that really interesting book that's put together by younger writers in her lineage. The republishing of Carrier Bag Theory of Fiction is just one of many reaffirmations of a heritage from Le Guin, that these two women, in a strong sense, are they are generatrix. They are generators of ongoingness for the young. They paid attention to that in their lives, those two people. And then their own fiction is amazing. So that if you take the Genesis trilogy of Butler, and Lillian Yapo in the novel Dawn, and the living on Kali, the spaceship, the sorts of miscegenated kinship making, so on and so forth. Yeah. They have everything to do with making kin. You think of Ursula Le Guin's Always Coming Home, that effort to come to terms with place and home in California. Her deep knowledge of and commitment to the indigenous peoples of California, mm-hmm. so forth. No surprise that these two women, in particular, inspire young artists and writers and old people.
So now we have people waiting for their turn.
Good, excellent.
So I'll just leave you with people.
Martin, do we need to use the microphone?
I'm here. Don't worry.
Okay, so please.
Vielleicht am besten so.
Ja, okay, great.
Hello.
Hi, thank you very much for the talk. My question was about the topic of sci-fi and violence and how one sort of translates violence, whether it's personal, social, political, historical, into a narrative, because narratives can often be sort of simplifications of very complex stories, and how I was wondering your opinion on how you translate very complex events into a narrative that can be understood from the outside. Does that make sense?
Well, yeah, I don't think that, yes, it does make sense. And I don't think that there's a general way to answer that ongoing question. I think it can only be answered in the writing of actual stories. And the obligation to tell a good story, to collect up the, so that your audience is brought into it and cares. So I think narrative both makes something, brings in some kinds of threads. Well, I think it both simplifies and complexifies. Okay, it doesn't just simplify. It has the permission to add imaginative elements, especially science fiction, that can then play roles that open up the unexpected. So it's not really addressing your question, but. Violence is not an abstraction, okay? The violence that a story deals with has to be made real in the body of the story, okay? And dealt with in its particularities, in its ferocity, and that there's no really abstract way to do it. Okay, I have an example I'm going to do very briefly. There's a writer and worker named Rebecca Hall who is currently publishing two graphic novels based on 18th and 19th century slavery, the Atlantic slave trade, and her own family's history. Rebecca is an Afro-American. I believe her mother is a Caribbean scholar. Her father was white, was the chair of the Communist Party USA for many years. She herself is a labor activist and lawyer, teacher, scholar. Did a PhD in the archives around women's rebellions on slave ships and in the early plantations in Virginia and other places in the then colonies, the U.S., what became the United States. She's doing graphic novels called Wake, W-A-K-E, In the Wake, but also Woke Wake. And she is... The issues of violence are everywhere in these novels, and her graphic artist colleague are doing an amazing job of refusing to let it become pornographic, so that in dealing with some certain kinds of stories with just half screen illustration, with edge illustrations and edge narrations, with various kinds of indirection that make it all the more powerful without letting it be pornographic, so that the audience doesn't get permission to enjoy the destruction. And for me as a reader of the draft, I always had shivers up and down my spine reading Rebecca's draft of the first of these two graphic novels, and her success at both bringing a level of violation and violence into the text without ever turning it into a kind of sexualized and pornographic experience for the reader. And I think that's hard.
Thank you very much.
We're not very techy here.
Walking, you're very techy. It's highly helpful. Hello.
Hello. Thank you so much. I have a question. I was just very curious that if somehow in your works or your, if you encountered the whole idea of interdependent co-arising, which forms the basis of Buddhist philosophy, and in particular really well developed the two sides, the dependent origination and the emptiness of any independent existence, especially in the middle way consequentialist school. So I was just curious if somehow, because it's a living practicing tradition, and then you have the figure of the bodhisattva who is always working for the benefit of all sentient beings. So I wondered if you have encountered this and how it may have intersected with your work. Thank you.
I should have a much thicker relationship. I have known about this, but in a kind of not in a deep way. Annika Smelik, my colleague in Utrecht, in the Netherlands, who is a practicing Buddhist, has probably been most helpful to me in introducing some of the concepts that you've talked about. But what I have not yet done is integrate that with my own ways of coming to becoming with and more biologically informed ways of thinking about that. But I think these are
you're frozen. Wait a second, you're frozen. Where is the wo könnte der Fehler liegen? Ich glaube nicht bei uns. Aber
rufst du sie jetzt an?
Ja. Thank you.
pass.
Awesome. Thank you.
I don't know how. How much of that reply was heard? Do you know?
So can you see, I'll just leave you like this.
I see the audience. Karen, how much of that reply was cut off? Do you have any idea?
You were just telling us something about your colleague in Utrecht.
In Utrecht. Well, the main point of what I was trying to say is that I think the codependent, co-arising, interdependent co-arising, and that particular depth of Buddhist thinking is a kind of natural ally to what I'm trying to do, and I think it should be more foregrounded and more integrated, and that particular way of thinking just could be playing a much larger role in our work than it has been, including my own.
So there's one more question, yes. I think.
No, I saw two already. So who was there? Angela and in the back here.
Okay.
So please. Yes, please, because otherwise she won't hear.
Hi, Donna. Thank you very much for your talk so far. I just wanted to go back. In the very beginning, you mentioned briefly the carrier bag versus the gun. And I feel like we're in a moment where it's almost like we have two large forces. One is like, you know, we see the very, what's the word I'm looking for now again? Basically violent, very patriarchal violence happening against the forces of the carrier bag. And I just wonder if you could maybe give us some sort of hope or how you...
That's a heavy task.
Hope. The capacity... You can hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. No question that the war machine and its... the military-industrial war machine and its extinctionist and extractionist forces have never been stronger. And I also think the peoples of the earth struggling for the earth have also never been stronger, oddly. I mean, we sometimes feel so defeated. But look around. Look at, let me just take Latin America. Look how many people and how many places are in the streets. Look all over the world. Look at what's going on in Hong Kong. Look at the struggles for environmental justice, for reproductive justice, for the anti-extinction work that's being done. I think that I'm not necessarily optimistic in the sense of feeling that the majority of the impending damage will be avoided. I think that a tremendous amount of that damage will not be avoided, actually. I'm not especially optimistic, almost not exactly pessimistic, but I think the forces of destruction are intensely strong and that it's beyond serious. And I think that the job of people like us is not necessarily to project winning and engaging in that sense of this being a war to win, so much as to cultivate the capacity to build flourishing lives and deaths with human and non-human beings now, and to make that now endure. And whoever wins, you know, in the future is unknowable and a kind of false goal. I think the best chance, actually, for the earth to be a flourish, the earth and its peoples, human and non-human, to be flourishing in 100 years, is if we extend the strength for a flourishing now. These are ways of thinking I learned from Deborah Bird Rose and from her teachers in Australia, from Arnhem Land and other peoples in Aboriginal Australia, who taught Deborah Bird Rose a way of thinking about the present as not some kind of instantaneous thing, but the space of responsibility to respond to those who came before, so as to leave to those who come after, whom we cannot see, a less violent place, less destroyed, more flourishing. So it's not exactly hope so much as a kind of serious joy in being with each other to build a flourishing living and dying in a thick now.
Yes.
Yes.
So we'll have one more question, Donna. Is that okay for you? Okay. Do you still have time?
Yes.
Hi.
Yes, and I don't even have a moiré pattern from the white lines. Anyhow, yes.
Hi, it's great to have the chance to speak with you, and I just want to touch a little bit on the idea of storytelling. So we spoke a bit about, and you spoke a bit about storytelling of others and how to relate to others and how to retell stories that we are told, and also thinking about other entities as well, things like stones or other elements. And today we kind of touched on some kind of like anthropocentric topics, and just wanted to ask you with relation to things like anthropomorphism, or and maybe with a particular focus on non-human animals, how do you feel about telling stories of non-human animals and sort of speculating about telling stories of things that can't speak, and what's your approach to that? Thank you.
Yeah. Well, it's various, and I'm not really against anthropomorphism, as long as there's also theriomorphism or animal morphism. I think these are possibilities for storytelling, and that if you're writing a fable, and the rules of you know, speaking animals are quite different from writing, let's say, stories of encounters of other organisms with each other, or human beings with other organisms in various situated ways. I have no objection to speaking animals in fables. You know, let the foxes speak. So I want to leave that aside for the moment. It doesn't mean the writing of fables, I think, is a really interesting craft. But for the moment, I'm rather more interested in what kind of fiction should be written or performed, or music written, or various modalities of storytelling, where the animals and plants remain animals and plants, and are not humanized in that sense, and how to construct those encounters in a narratively convincing way. Well, for that, I think we need to be in alliance with the ecological behaviorist, the folks who are studying ecological and evolutionary behavioral capacities of being, that don't produce human speech all the time, including not for us all the time, because a whole lot of what we do is not linguistic. Our particular strength in language, but we don't have to deny it either. So maybe the best example of fiction like this so far for me is a recent novel called Semiosis. And the chief non-human player in this novel is a kind of bamboo-like clone, a distributed plant with really interesting kinds of chemical communication through the rhizomes sort of mobilize the plants in interesting ways, including if the human settlers in this particular valley do things that damage the plants, the fruit that the plants produce that were originally nourishing to the humans become toxic. So the animals mobilize themselves to domesticate the humans so that their agriculture works to the advantage of the plants, not just the plants the humans are growing, but other plants in the ecosystem. So there's this very interesting struggle, not always struggle, sometimes alliance, sometimes struggle, between the colonial human beings and the indigenous plants and animals, that also involves the humans becoming progressively aware that there was a previous failed colonization of a non-human species that failed to recognize the semiotic capacities of the other critters on the planet, who don't work through human language, but through a semiosis based on chemistry. I think that did that novel. There are ways that novel failed too, but I thought that novel took on the problem in a really seriously interesting way.
Yes, super. So thanks a lot for your time, Donna. We will do our very best to play and struggle in serious joy for the rest of the night. I hope you're having plans like that as well.
Yeah,
so what
it's raining here, which is good. So thanks for letting me come.
No, thanks okay. a lot for your time. That was great. And have a good time over there.
Well, next okay. Bye-bye. Bye, Karen.
Bye. See you soon. Ciao.
What was that?
Danke auch dir, Karin. Du, vielen Dank. Und ich möchte mich jetzt nochmal wirklich ganz herzlich bei allen, auch beim Publikum, nochmal herzlich bedanken. I would like to thank also the audience and all the participants in the program, the speakers, Angela Anderson, Dechal Shah, who presented their films yesterday, Nina Dabasumi, who joined the discussion yesterday, and today Elisabeth von Samsonov, who left because she anyway was here for a long time but felt sick already, Anita Fuchs, who presented the projects by Resanita about plant research and biodiversity. Then in the afternoon, I think you, Michaela Moser, for your presentation of the Wohnprojekt Wien and this insight in sociocracy. And after Michaela, thank you, Dechal, for your lecture, and you will have a workshop on Tuesday. Edith Yeshapkova, very warm thank you to you also. And after Edith, it was Karin who took the chance to talk about the translation of Donna Haraway, and of course thanks also to Donna Haraway, who was willing to join us. I also would like Karin, take Donna by her word and invite you to spend some time together, to enjoy each other. I organized even some music upstairs, so there is a piano player waiting for us. We can have a glass of wine or water, and I think there is even some food left from lunch and some cakes. So please join us for a while, and then we can also continue the more informal talks. Thank you all for being so patient today. Also thanks to Martin Eigner, who was our technician for today, and Herwig Niederer, who did the video documentation of the whole day. So thank you very much.